Today we're talking about China, a country that currently has a love-hate relationship with Trump. With all these threats and sanctions, I'm not sure whether people who do business over there are traders or traitors. So why am I talking about this today? Well, there have been a recent flurry of informal agreements and rebuffs to those agreements as China tries to get one of its products into the US market, the ZTE phone. The fourth largest phone manufacturer in the world, and the number one way to talk to China without paying long distance charges. Trust me, they're listening. Recently, after ZTE was found to have illegally broken sanctions in giving US technology to North Korea and Iran, the US Department of Commerce banned American companies from selling ZTE software and hardware for 7 years, which put their company on the verge of bankruptcy. Because Americans buy new phones so often that new phone who dis is actually a popular phrase here. It also made sure that crucial mechanical parts like the NVIDIA chips that make phones work were not sold to ZTE. So ZTE might have gone from a phone company to a phone case company. So yeah, that was not great for ZTE products. Which led to
the pushback from here on Capitol Hill about President Trump's decision to reverse trade restrictions against telecommunications China giant ZTE is continuing.
Alright, so now they can sell stuff in America? Well, again, no. Because after that, the House approved an amendment to a bill that put sanctions on ZTE that said that bill would prevent a foreign company that is beholden to its government and that ignores embargoes from infiltrating the devices and networks that are indispensable to American life. Now, this couldn't have been less subtle if it mentioned ZTE by name. Oh well, there's a country that's beholden to its government but doesn't violate embargoes. Infiltrate away! But you better keep that crap away from Iran and North Korea. Wouldn't want North Korea getting their hands on cell phone technology. At the current technological level, the string needs to be tight for them to order that ICBM strike. No, I'm not kidding. They seem to be a little too proud of having achieved a non-cordless landline technology. I wonder if one of the reasons you haven't nuked America is because you're unsure what will happen to America Online. That government probably still has 300 free hours of internet left. So back to our main story with ZTE, because 7 years without American markets is terrible for business, but it's just a small part of a larger picture because
the Washington Post has obtained a list of demands from the Chinese government to the U.S. ahead of high-level trade talks. The Post reporting the demands range from reasonable to kind of ridiculous. President Trump has already caved on one of those demands, instructing his Commerce Department to help the Chinese tech company ZTE get back in business.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. We're still supposed to be in the nonpartisan part of the show. Some people say he caved, while predictably, other people say he's negotiating using the tools provided to him. The point here is, what is this list? Well, briefly, let's go over it, because surprisingly, it's 9 points. Including the ZTE sanctions repeal. So first, we have the ZTE sanctions repeal, and the second demand was the United States commits to eliminating the sanctions imposed after China's crackdown on protesters in Tiananmen Square in 1989. First, you're telling me there's a product we don't currently buy from China? Well, it's actually the other way around. The US refuses to sell arms to China, and we will not have high-level military talks with them. Now, both these rules have been stretched by executive order because, well, it's one of the things the US likes to do is sell weapons. And apparently if you want to work with China on constraining North Korea, you might have to meet with them at some point. The next Chinese demand is the United States relaxes export restrictions on technologies such as integrated circuits. Okay, China, you went a little too specific with that one. That would be like your teenage kids saying, you need to respect my privacy more, such as not opening the bottom drawer in my wardrobe. Or maybe something else, we can workshop it. Yes, we won't ship China our top technology because they respect intellectual property about as much as a teenager who just learned about Pirate Bay. Next, they want The United States to allow U.S. government agencies to purchase and use Chinese information technology products and services. What could go wrong there? Oh wait, I'm being told everything. Although it's not as though China constantly tries to hack our government agencies, but if this went through, I think it would be about as much hacking as accepting a donation is stealing. Never fear though, because I have faith in our administrative leaders to make the right choices in this area. Like Ben Carson, Scott Pruitt, and Rick Perry, and oh, alright, yep, this one probably isn't a good idea. Next demand? The United States agrees to treat Chinese investment and investors equally to those of other countries, and place no restrictions on Chinese investment. And here I was, living naively in America, thinking that all money was treated equally in this country. Well, according to Xinhua Net, a website that might have a little bit of an agenda, the US has put limits on how much the Chinese can invest in American science and technology. Because, citing national security, we don't want to give Chinese inventors access to our intellectual secrets. Next, the United States agrees to ensure Chinese businesses can participate in US infrastructure projects. Oh, come on! Roads are one of the last things we can make here! You can't take that away from us! That said, now that you mention it, we are looking for someone who's good at building walls. The next demand is a bit on the funny side, but they demand that the United States agrees to strengthen protection of Chinese intellectual property. And it's a serious problem for the Chinese. I mean, Americans have been making blatant and very successful knockoffs of these Chinese brands. Does this look familiar? Obama fried chicken? Yeah, wow, I'm starting off a little racist, I see. Well, we knocked that one off pretty hard. Or what about the poor victims of IP theft who started Sunbucks? I mean, we have so many Americans who stole Chinese ideas, it's sad. We got Arm & Hatchet. Heck, we even stole their John Daphne Tenderness Whiskey. Now with extra antifreeze. I could list off examples all day. Well, now, it's easy to make fun of those. So easy, in fact, that I would even break the comedy rule of threes because I found a fourth one that was so good. But according to Chris P. Foley, who wrote down the yawn-inducing piece protecting Chinese company trademark rights in the US, as more and more Chinese companies sell their products in the US market or introduce their services into the US, there has been an increasing number of Chinese business trademarks preemptively registered in the US and elsewhere. Now, I realize it feels hard to feel sorry for business people who have ruined our IPs more than typing in the name of your favorite cartoon character into DeviantArt. But it is a problem. Chinese IP protections are awarded based surely on first one to apply with this copyright material gets it. While US copyright is based on actual use of the copyright and distinguishing products and sales. This means that if you can start selling things in the US before the Chinese company does, you can steal their brand. Take for example, China International Travel Service, who successfully sued an ex-employee who started US China International Travel Service using their brand and logo. So the next demand is, the United States agrees to drop its anti-dumping cases against China at the World Trade Organization. Okay, so dumping, and not the kind that takes my roommate 2 hours every darn day. Nope, dumping is when you sell a product at well below market price, with the goal of putting competition out of business so that you can dominate the market. China is accused of doing this with steel, and we're currently suing them for it in the World Trade Organization. Now, before I go on to the next argument, I need to let you guys know that the US too has successfully been sued for dumping cotton, so we're not exactly squeaky clean. But that's because our agricultural subsidies are bordering on the absurd. The final demand is, the United States agrees to terminate its investigations into Chinese intellectual property theft and not impose any of the sanctions Trump already announced. Oh boy, China, that's one heck of a ninth demand. What they're talking about here is, first, a demand for Trump to stop a current investigation into Chinese intellectual property theft from 1974 onward that, according to trade law, would allow him to apply sanctions and tariffs on Chinese goods until China changed their trade policies. Yeah, no real surprise, China doesn't like that one. Second, it seems like they're not a big fan of the US putting tariffs on steel and aluminum coming from China. Seems as though it's harder to dump materials when their prices are being artificially inflated on the other side. All in all, I could see why Trump would look at this list and say, well, let's keep selling ZTE phones in our country. That said, it's not like he was forced to do any of the things on this list. With all this put into context, let's go to the newsroom. First to you, Fox.
That it's really a way to get more American jobs. You have to remember on the Chinese company, we're a big supplier to them. That's why they ostensibly said we're going to be going out of business, because we've cut off their supplies from companies like Qualcomm and NVIDIA. So in effect, helping them does help our job.
That almost makes sense. Thing is, if we end the punishment of ZTE, that won't help or hurt. It'll just maintain the status quo. That would be like me taking my arm out of a cast and thinking, I'm stronger than ever. Still though, good to know we're still making products of value.
I'm not sure that he's going to do that. Now, the president's not afraid to float a balloon here and float a balloon there. But what we do know about this president is he keeps his word and he is a great negotiator. So some of the rumors that have come out about some deal on ZTE that would wipe away the concerns we've had on a company that we think can steal intellectual property, but also can spy on Americans. I don't think the president's going to make that kind of a deal.
Yeah, that's the thing with this president that some people don't seem to get. He floats a balloon here, floats a balloon there. Sure, it gets to the point where they turned into Cleveland when they released 1.5 million balloons and it clogged everything for days. But you see this all the time with him.
Take the firearms first and then go to court.
Yeah, that balloon got shot down pretty quick. There was a whole other solar border wall idea, the whole Space Force thing. He just throws things out and sees if it plays. And the ZTE idea did not. In contrast, though, he does show determination to maintain his campaign promises, regardless of whether literally everyone tells him not to do something. This is just him throwing out balloons to see if it'll float in these trade negotiations.
Just think of China 10 or 15 years from now, how large they are, and their military will be that much more advanced as well. So how do you deal with these issues 10 or 15 years from now, when they're that much larger and that much more powerful? The president understands you have to deal with these fundamental trade issues today. It's easier today than it would be in the future. And that means making sure China opens up its markets, reduces its tariffs and barriers, but also stops requiring us to transfer our intellectual property to them when we manufacture within their country.
He's right. We need to define our trade relations with these countries now rather than later. If only we didn't have to do it one country at a time and instead could create some sort of free trade partnership of trans-Pacific nations designed to lower tariffs, increase trade, and protect U.S. intellectual property rights.
Donald Trump has fulfilled a key campaign pledge by withdrawing the U.S. from the 12-nation Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Oh, having a memory that's better than a goldfish's is a curse. Now, I do want to point out one extremely weird argument to the point where, what the heck are you talking about? When asked whether China, a country that can plan 30 to 100 years out, has an advantage over us, who have elections and changing leaders, this congressman said, and remember, this was 3 days ago.
You know, they're probably on a 100-year horizon. You know, we're on a 100-day horizon. But with a president who doesn't...
No, I mean, that's hard to compete with,
no,
right?
But with a president who has nothing to lose and who keeps his promises, it's with Iran or North Korea or nuclear deals...
He's right. We can rely on China to stick to this 100-year deal, just like they can rely on us. Just look at Iran and the nuclear deal and... Oh wait, why are you leaving? So... The large takeaway from Fox News' side is A, Donald Trump is just throwing stuff out and we shouldn't take what he says too seriously until we have something on paper. And B, a benefit of bringing ZTE back into the fold would be an increase in domestic jobs. Also, These conversations need to happen because we pulled out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, so trade between us and China is currently a bit anarchic. Now it's time to see what CNBC is saying. Although, fair warning, they're bluer than the Democratic colors right now.
President Trump says he's working hard to save jobs.
Told you he would.
Yeah. Well, those jobs are in China.
What?
The president tweeted yesterday morning that President Xi and I are working together to give massive Chinese phone company ZTE a way to get back into business fast. Too many jobs in China lost.
Wait, hold on. Hold on. Nick Confessori, I'm confused. Too many jobs in China lost. I thought he was campaigning about how China was taking too many of our jobs.
You get it? Yeah, that went on for a long time, including, of course, a China imitation.
Elise, last time I went to Moss Point, Mississippi, nobody down there was saying, Joe, you know what I think the biggest problem is? That there are too many jobs lost in China.
I'm worried about job growth in China.
I am worried about China. But Donald Trump is saying, can we say Trump, colon, make China great again across
yes,
the bottom, please?
That's a good
there. Oh, look at that. Boom. They already had it.
Yes. Yeah. It's funny, but I just watched 5 minutes of you making the same joke over and over again. Isn't this going to transition into a news show at some point? Now, finally, after a bit that is never going to get old, I mean, Donald Trump just tweeted that we need to defend Chinese jobs. Come on, guys, the president would never tweet something if he hadn't fully thought it through. So, after probably the equivalent amount of time it took me to explain China's list of demands to you, the news actually started reporting, well, news.
One How's assumes. The Davos crowd taking it?
Yeah.
Just fine.
They have to love him now.
No, one assumes.
It's, no, seriously.
It's wrapped up into the larger trade negotiations. You had the U.S. delegation went to China. It was a fiasco. China's chief economic trade minister, Liu He, is coming to Washington this week.
Yep.
This is obviously part of that. Exactly what the details China's going to give the president will remains to be seen. But this is part of that kind of a
choreography. Oh, so John Meacham. Donald Trump is
yes.
learning a year and a half in that being president of the United States actually isn't as easy as it seems to be. And sometimes there are trade-offs that you have to make. And it's not as easy as just going out and throwing red meat into the crowd saying we're going to destroy China.
Well, at least someone learned something for a fleeting second before NBC realized they hadn't taken a dig at the president in the last 10 seconds. There's a quota, you guys. All right, I'm going to seriously use a different source because I might have learned negative watching that. Well, there was a lot of reporters talking about that tweet. They could have put on a whole comedy special. I ended up watching CBS. Sorry, NBC. To find this interesting report.
ZTE cannot operate without these goods from America. And so the Chinese have made it very clear that they need the U.S. and its products. The question is, if it is violating sanctions and if it is a U.S. security threat, why should the U.S. care?
It's good to be thinking again. Why should the U.S. care? Well, she asked White House spokesperson Raj Shah, and you're never going to guess, he actually recalled. Although, unsurprisingly, it might have been a more satisfactory answer if he had forgotten. He said, "This is part of a very complex relationship between the United States and China that involves economic issues, national security issues, and the likes." Honestly, though, I feel like this is a pretty accurate interpretation for exactly what is going on here. It's complicated. Trump got handed a list and decided to try to do the simplest thing on it. As you do. Yeah, I'm not gonna do my taxes before I take out the trash, mow the lawn, and do literally anything else on my list. So he took that first idea, made it into a balloon, really tried to get people on board, and it failed. I look forward to seeing what he chooses from that list to do next, and thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan comedy news, remember to subscribe by clicking my eagle, or do it the old-fashioned way by clicking the subscribe button below. And remember to give me a thumbs up!